Hi, everybody, and thank you for joining today's call with GomSpace on our Investor Day. My name is Benjamin Silverstone. I am the equity analyst at ABG covering GomSpace, and today I have the pleasure of having Niels Buus with me, who is going to introduce us to this exciting case. Niels, thank you very much for being here today, and without further ado, I will now give the word to you. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you for having me. I would like to start my presentation now. I think you are not on my picture. Are you showing the presentation or? You should run my presentation. You shouldn't run your presentation. Sorry about that. Something is wrong with my presentation.
Let me see. So is it from your side, Niels, or from our side?
Yes. Of course, I would like to present GomSpace today. But before I do that, I would like to point out three things that I would like you to bring from this presentation here. The first thing is, what is the new space economy? If you are interested in space and if you want to invest in space, the new space economy and understanding the new space economy is very, very important. So I will start doing that. And when I do that, I will tell you a little bit about this picture here. The next thing is, what is GomSpace? In general, if you're interested in space, GomSpace is worthwhile to know what that is. But if you're interested in our company and interested in investing, that's obviously very important. So I would like to explain you what GomSpace is, and I will tell you about this picture. The last thing is, why should you invest in GomSpace? And that is the core and I will explain why that could be useful for you. But before I do that, or when I do that, I'll show you about this picture here. But before I do that, I would like to present myself. I am one of the lucky persons who had my face on the Times Square. I think it was there for 3 seconds. So I've experienced to have a great success. I've also experienced to have big troubles. We had a customer that unfortunately couldn't finance their big order with us, so we've had to cut down on the company. I've tried restructuring. I've tried to have rapid growth. So I think I'm very qualified for the venture that we are standing in front of as a company right now. But let me begin with the three points that I want to go through. The first thing is, what is the new space economy? And I promised you to look at this picture. And let's look at this for a moment. This is the SpaceX Starship, the Starship that's going to go to the moon, intended to go to Mars, and it can actually contain 100 people. It's more than 50 meters long, and it's one of the big challenges or goals that one of those so-called space barons have put. The likes of Elon Musk, Richard Branson, Jeff Bezos, they have really ignited the new space era. They have started the new ventures that's going on all around the world. They have made wild goals to go to Mars. They've inspired and amazed. And I think they've also brought people to shake their head. But nonetheless, it's really moving forward in this business at the moment. Many countries have, on the back of that, started their own space ventures. space organizations. They can now have access to technology. They can have access to being part of exploring space and create their own wealth in the future of space, which is something that is very, very important. I think it's more than 75 countries now have their own space organizations. It has also started large space investments in new space companies. A lot of venture capital is going into this business segment, and that is something that is also pushing this business very much. The last thing is that the established space companies, they are being threatened at the moment, and that is encouraging, they are pushing them to start to make new solutions where the space, new space market or the new technology is coming in as well, which is also something that is having a lot of new opportunities in the market. And the space market is something that is growing. It is growing from 350 billion last year to 1500 billion in 2040. So a long-term growth is something that is expected into the future. And obviously, at the same time, the market is growing. The technology is becoming smaller, more accessible. The numbers are going to go up. So the numbers of nanosatellites in the future, or small satellites, are going to go up with a very high pace, do we expect. So this we are developing together with our colleagues and our competitors. We don't see a big urge for any consolidation. That does not make sense in our view in a growing market. So it's about creating new business. It's about creating new opportunities. Okay, that was the first part of it. The next part is, what is GomSpace? And I promised you to tell you about this picture here. This is our headquarters in Aalborg, only a few 2 kilometers from where the company was founded as a spin out from the university in Aalborg by 3 students. The company is a developer and producer of nanosatellites. And we're very keen on saying nanosatellites and not microsatellites and others, because we want to come from beneath to make the technology light and small and very powerful, even though it's small. The company was founded in 2007. I had the pleasure of being the first chairman of the company and took over as the CEO in 2014. It was funded by the local seed environment community up here. And since 2016, we were on the stock exchange in Stockholm. We have subsidiaries in Luxembourg, Sweden, and the United States. And as I pointed out last time we were in here, we are looking at other countries as well, primarily European countries, where we have the more ESA opportunities, but also because some countries have their space ventures financed by national money that requires that the satellites and the workforce and the work is taking place in their particular country. So that is something that we will have to adhere to and are certainly considering very seriously. I'll get back to that a little bit later in the next part of the presentation. The satellites are growing in size. The first satellites were 1U, 10 by 10 by 10 centimeters. They've grown to 2U, 3U, 6U, 8U, the one that never came about. And finally, the last one, a 12U satellite, which is where we are at the moment. And we are making what we call a GOMX 5 satellite for the ESA environment at the moment. But that satellite is also going to be the backbone of what we are going to do in the future. And you can see here the GOMX 5 satellite, very big solar panels to harvest a lot of energy, very big antennas to make advanced communication and radio wave communication in different kinds. And that is a satellite that is able to produce energy and communication at a rate the same size as satellites that could be 5-6 times as big as ours, That's important because it's very expensive to send satellites into space. So the lighter they are, the less expensive it is to send them up and to replenish them at a later stage. Obviously, the satellites are going to work in constellations, something we've spoken about a lot of times. And this is our ultimate goal, is to make constellations of satellites into space so that that is going to be the backbone of the growth of the company. And obviously, when we send satellites up into space, and many satellites, we have to have an efficient way of running them, controlling them, and managing them. We all know the picture of the left, where you can see a lot of people in a control center running one or two satellites or things like that. That does not work in our environment. We are creating a software package where we are networking the satellites, working together, you can say cloud in second order, where they're working together seamlessly, automatically, sending messages down to if there's any errors, or even preparing themselves in space. This is the kind of thing that we have made with our constellation management software in Luxembourg. The most important thing on the satellite is the data that it can create, and that is determined by the payload, and the payload is the instrument that can measure and communicate. We have been among the very first, if not the first, who could run tracking of airlines from a nanosatellite. We did that with GOMX-1, we did it with GOMX-3. We had very interesting data on the MHL-70, not at the time it fell down, but that kind of thing. We have done VHF studies with VHF radios from space for the Singapore Air Navigational Service provider. And just recently, earlier this month on the 10th, we announced that we made an order of 150 million Swedish kroner with the Spanish technology provider Indra, they have now told what that is for, and that is for running building up an air traffic management system on a global scale with ADS-B transponder on board, but also VHF on board. And the order we announced of the three in-orbit demonstration satellites is building that technology, that is going to be delivered over the next 3 years. This is a major step for us, utilizing the capabilities we have, and also a major step to building the company to the next level. We have not won the constellation on this project. The constellation is largely going to be funded by Spanish government money, and that means that we will have our considerations how to position ourselves in the best way to do that, and that will give considerations about how we can have work done in Spain as well. So this is, as I said, a major first step in the right direction. And it's also, you could say, proof on the way to proof of technology with one of the big advanced technology providers, not only new space startup companies, but for real business, for real demanding customers with very high demand of service quality. So this is a big step for us, and this is something that's going to give a lot of new employees in the company, expected to create future, even more future growth. Okay, enough about that. Now, when the satellite is made, we send them into space, and we do that with dedicated rockets for dedicated tracks, so that they can make the right coverage. The satellite can be at the right place at the right time in connection with each other. That requires precise launches of the satellites. And this is an example of a Rocket Labs launch from the southern tip of a peninsula in New Zealand. It goes without saying that there's a lot of vibration, so the satellites have to be very rugged so that they can withstand that vibration when they are sent up. there's a lot of issues about insurances and quality and things like that, because the responsibility of the satellite is handed over to the customer when they are put at the tip of the satellite. Okay. The next thing is that once they are up, they are put into operation. And you can see that with this kind of satellite, this is the GOM-X3 satellite, actually. Once they are up, they have a very, very good breadth of view. They can see a lot of things. They can track every aircraft. They have free field of view in a lot of directions. And after that, the work on putting them into operation and running them is the key case for running the satellite operation. Okay, we are at the moment, and with this, we are taking a big step of maturing the nanosatellite business. And still we maintain to call it nanosatellite because we want to keep them as small as possible. 16U, 20U satellites is something that we will be working towards in this kind of configuration. Okay, next one. Why should you invest in GomSpace? First of all, you can invest in GomSpace because we're on the stock exchange. That's what that picture says. Enough about that now. We have a very strong executive team, a non-executive team at the GomSpace. Jens Måhle, the former head of Terma, is the chairman of the board. He is very experienced in running this kind of technology. He knows everything about how to do that in detail, how to bring it, organize it, and all that kind of thing. And then I have a very, very talented young CFO. He was here right from the beginning, and he's been able to develop throughout this, and he's got a lot of more potential into the future as well. We have grown 19 times since 2013, as I say, growth and growing the company is the number one target. Obviously, we need to make sure we have the cash for it, and we do have the cash for it, but the growth is something that is very important because we need to capture market size, a market share in this kind of business. The order intake was officially was a little bit slow in the first quarter, but just outside the quarter we closed the Unseen Lab order, and now we have closed the other order put at 150. So we nearly doubled our order book within a month, a month and a half. So that is going very well indeed. The next thing is the revenue. The first quarter was a little bit disappointed. It is usually in such a way that the revenue in the first quarter is lower than in the fourth quarter, even though we are growing. So it is like a sword-shaped growth that we're always running. But it was also a little bit slower than expected. We some accruals that went into the fourth quarter instead of the first quarter that did some of it. The next thing is that we have problems or challenges like everybody else with advanced electronics components that have taken out some of the revenue on the high earnings runners of products. We have had to rearrange the manufacturing. But we are maintaining the outlooks so there's nothing changed in our ambition for the company as such. the operating profit was, for the reason I just explained to you, lower than expected, but we maintain our ambition. The net working capital goes back towards zero, but nevertheless, all of it is very good, and the cash position is good and solid as we expected. So with these small variations that I think you should anticipate in this kind of business where we are shaking it up with some big orders and so much work we're putting on, we are very satisfied with the progression. Okay, with that, I would show this picture here. Could be in your back garden. seeing a line of Starlink's satellites coming up, across just shortly after they've sent up and before they've spread out in a total orbit. But these Starlink satellites, they are an example on how the new space business is now challenging the established service players. Inmarsat and others who have geostationary satellites that are not very good for running back and forth of internet because of the long distance and the long time it takes for the data to flow. You need to be closer to the Earth. So these Starlink will do that, but those service providers will also need to have a solution for those who are now starting to compete them and to compete against them. And that is something that we believe is going to give us an opportunity to be part of that future solution. So with that, I would like to thank you for your attention and we'll be ready for questions.
Thank you very much, Nils, for the very informative presentation. I do have two follow-up questions, if we could sort of begin with that. The first one is in regards to the Indra order, which you mentioned. You obviously won the demonstration part of it. Could you give some indication of how big the actual opportunities would be if you were to win, let's say, the actual constellation? And also perhaps just give some more nuances to which sort of hurdles you had to overcome to win this order. I do know that you mentioned potential have some operation in Spain or know how to produce in Spain, or would there be any other hurdles that you would sort of be looking out for in order to be able to compete for this order? And the final question would be if you could give some, just a brief clarification of which aspects makes GomSpace competitive today when we look at, you know, new and also old space competitors. Thank you.
Yeah. First, regarding Indra, themselves are pointing out in their press releases and in their communication that that it's about 200 satellites that will be required for a constellation. The final number, whether that's 150 or 300, that's not decided yet. That's something that the technical solution will determine in the end. So that's one part of it. The other part of it is that it is a challenging project. Unfortunately, we have tested most of this kind of things before, so we know how to do it. We know how to make this this kind of satellites. So that's good. We this is what I'm saying now is entirely from our perspective. Obviously, when Indra is on a customer is going to go out and buy a lot of satellites, they have to make sure that there's proper competition to have the right price. So it's fully understandable that they will be looking around to make sure that they, when they go into an acquisition process, they are pushing the situation the best possible. However, we have made the satellites. We will have made the satellites at that time. So that is also a good position. We have already now started our own work on positioning ourselves to be able to be the strongest possible when that time comes. So we will be fighting with everything we have to try to win that order when it comes about. We are in a business where we have to understand that we have to operate in other countries. So that's something that we must learn in any case. That's how I look this situation.
Thank you, Nils.
With regard to competing with the big service providers, it's actually the same challenge as with this opportunity here, is that that we have to raise the quality level, quality and reliability level that the nanosatellites or new space is operating under. Excuse me, just quick. If you take the Starlink satellite that Elon Musk sent up, about 20% of the satellite does not work because it's like or work properly. It's like pushing a lot of satellite up and then relying on the majority of the satellites is working. That's not how the established players is working. They want quality and reliability. And that's a transformation that we will be working on in GomSpace. So that maturing part of it, that's also what I was putting into with the presentation, maturing the company with that. And that takes a lot of effort, and that takes a lot of work over the next period of time. But we also believe that doing that, making these small satellites available for the real professional world, is the major opportunity. It's not a short term, it's a little bit longer term, it's a cumbersome process, but we believe it's going to be a major opportunity for the company and the one that will be standing best in the future.
Thank you very much, Nils, and thank you very much for being here today. Due to the time, we'll have to end the call here, but it was interesting as always to hear more about the case. Thank you.
And I hope you have a good day. Thank you for letting me come. Bye-bye.